The Tenant of Wildfell Hall by Anne Brontë. Volume 1. Prefatory Letter to J. Halford, Esquire. Dear Halford, when we were together last, you gave me a very particular and interesting account of the most remarkable occurrences of your early life, previous to our acquaintance, and then you requested a return of confidence from me. Not being in a story-telling humour at the time, I declined, under the plea of having nothing to tell, and the like shuffling excuses, which were regarded as wholly inadmissible by you. For though you instantly turned the conversation, it was with an air of an uncomplaining but deeply injured man, and your face was overshadowed with a cloud which darkened it to the end of our interview, and, for what I know, darkens it still. For your letters have ever since been distinguished by a certain dignified, semi-melancholy stiffness and reserve that would have been very affecting if my conscience had accused me of deserving it. Are you not ashamed, old boy, at your age, and when we have known each other so intimately and so long, and when I have already given you so many proofs of frankness and confidence, and never resented your comparative closeness and taciturnity? But there it is, I suppose. You are not naturally communicative, and you thought you had done great things and given an unparalleled proof of friendly confidence on that memorable occasion, which doubtless you have sworn shall be the last of the kind. And you deemed that the smallest return I could make for so mighty a favour would be to follow your example without a moment's hesitation. Well, I did not take up my pen to reproach you, nor to defend myself, nor to apologize for past offences, but if possible to atone for them. It is a soaking, rainy day. The family are absent on a visit. I am alone in my library, and have been looking over certain musty old letters and papers, and musing on past times, so that I am now in a very proper frame of mind for amusing you with an old-world story, and having withdrawn my well-roasted feet from the hobs, wheeled round to the table, and indited the above lines to my crusty old friend, I am about to give him a sketch. No, not a sketch. A full and faithful account of certain circumstances connected with the most important event of my life, previous to my acquaintance with Jack Halford, at least. And when you have read it, charge me with ingratitude and unfriendly reserve, if you can. I know you like a long story, and are as great a stickler for particularities and circumstantial details as my grandmother, so I will not spare you. My own patience and leisure shall be my only limits. Among the letters and papers I spoke of, there is a certain faded old journal of mine, which I mention by way of assurance that I have not my memory alone, tenacious as it is, to depend upon. In order that your credulity may not be too severely taxed in following me through the minute details of my narrative, to begin then at once with chapter first, for it shall be a tale of many chapters. Chapter 1. You must go back with me to the autumn of 1827. My father, as you know, was a sort of gentleman farmer in Blankshire, and I, by his express desire, succeeded him in the same quiet occupation, not very willingly, for ambition urged me to higher aims, and self-conceit assured me that in disregarding its voice I was burying my talent in the earth and hiding my light under a bushel. My mother had done her utmost to persuade me that I was capable of great achievements. But my father, who thought ambition was the surest road to ruin, and change but another word for destruction, would listen to no scheme for bettering either my own condition or that of my fellow mortals. He assured me it was all rubbish, and exhorted me with his dying breath to continue in the good old way, to follow his steps and those of his father before him, and let my highest ambition be to walk honestly through the world, looking neither to the right hand nor to the left, and to transmit the paternal acres to my children in at least as flourishing a condition as he left them to me. Well, an honest and industrious farmer is one of the most useful members of society, and if I devote my talents to the cultivation of my farm and the improvement of agriculture in general, I shall thereby benefit not only my own immediate connections.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.